Hello, God bless you, and welcome to the House of His Glory. I'm Pastor Deidre Campbell Jones, and I am asking you to stick around right after this brief introduction, and we will be back with our service for today. Log in, sign in, and chat with us. We're going to have a great day in store for you. Hello once again. This is Pastor Deidre Campbell Jones here at the House of His Glory. We are a totally digital e-church congregation. We have been for the last 4.5, almost 5 years now. And if you are visiting for the first time, members, family, friends, partners, welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm going to put up on the screen once again all of our new platform addresses. I hope that you have found us, that you have logged in on the new platform, because the old platform is shut down. It doesn't exist anymore. So now you can find us at any live link from our main website, thehouseofhisglory.com, or if you'd like to go direct to the new platform, it is hohgchurch.sermon.net. There we go. hohgchurch.sermon.net. And of course, you can watch us anytime from anywhere on the app, which is found at any app store for your iOS or Android phone. And the app is called iChurch for Life. iChurch for Life. All right, we are in the second week of August. We are in the second week of our revival. It is revival month here, and God is reviving us. He is starting a plan to bring forth His glory, to manifest His glory in the earth in these latter days. And it is going to start with those people who ignite, reignite, and just take on the fire of God in revival in this season. And so the House of His Glory is doing our part, and all month long we are reviving the vision. And so let's go before our Heavenly Father right now in prayer and just thank Him for this message, thank Him for this time together, and invite Him to light this service on fire. Amen. Father God, we love you so much. We thank you so much. I am so excited for what you have in store for today. And so, Father, I ask you that in the midst of all the things we are still facing through coronavirus, through the resurgence of more deaths and more people contracting the illness, all the things that we are still facing in regards to police brutality and the injustices and discrimination and violence against minorities, all the things we are still facing in this country in regard to the upcoming election, all the things that we still may be facing in our own families, the difficulties on our jobs, all the things that we are still struggling with to feed families, to keep our income coming in, to pay our bills, all of the things that people still may be fighting against, their health and recovery, that they would be healed, that they would walk in wholeness, that they would recover of any disease and sickness and illness. Father, even those who are still in grief and in mourning over the loss of loved ones, no matter what it is that we have come through, that we have been through, that we are still struggling with, that we are still facing from day to day, Father, I ask you now in the name of Jesus, as you have brought each one watching and listening to this time and this place, no matter when, no matter from where, Father God, that you would indeed ignite and reignite a purpose, a hope, the possibility of the impossibilities that can be done, of change, of deliverance, of salvation, Father God, that you would whisper to our hearts and our minds and our souls that there is a plan, that there is a purpose, that there is change coming, that there is hope coming, that there is glory coming, that your Spirit can fill us, can empower us, can surround us, can lead us, can guide us, can teach us, can heal us in the name of Jesus. And so, Father, if there is anyone who does not know you and does not know your Son or has not confessed your Son as their own Lord and Savior, Father, draw them to you now, that they would know you are real, that you know, that they would know that you love them, that they would be drawn to make that confession that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that they believe you raised him from the dead for the forgiveness of their sins, and that they would come to you asking you to be their Father, to be their God, to cleanse them of all unrighteousness and set them on a path of purpose, power, and glory with you. That is my prayer, Father God, that you would use this message, that you would use this time to heal bodies, to give solutions to problems, answers to questions, answers to prayers, that you would open our eyes to the future and the hope that you have for each one of us today, right now, and through the house of his glory. And most of all, Father, we thank you for Jesus Christ. We thank you for your indwelling Spirit. We thank you for this message today. I pray that all who hear it would hear you and not me, that they would hear themselves, that they would hear the possibility for their lives through this message. And in this service, as we dedicate this time to you, laying aside every distraction and burden and weight, Father God, that you would ignite us, revive us, refresh us, renew us, and set us on a path to restart our life with you in Jesus Christ. We thank you, we praise you, we glorify you, and magnify your holy name. And it is in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray this prayer. Amen. Amen, and God bless you. Can't you tell I am riled up and ready for revival? Let's go right now into this song of praise, and we will start our second message in our revival month for today. God bless you. I'll be right back.
Where are you now when darkness seems to win? Where are you now when the world is crumbling? Oh, I hear you say, I hear you say, look up, child.
A perfect match, strike the match, ignite. And light. A city on a hill just cannot be hid, out in the open to see what you did. He won the bid, now finished, deed done, seed planted like a tree, now planted and grown for purpose and desire. Light the fire, ignite. So bright, now baptized and given a new start to be driven, not dead, now living like a star to be seen, made right like a dream, gleaming in the sky, light and the daylight, now shining so bright like the sun, ignite. Shine and arise with decided decision and open eyes to the vision. So bright is the mission, not impossible, empowered and electrified position to stand and admire the one who lights us on fire, Jesus the Sun. Shine bright. Ignite. Relight. As we are talking about revival this month, as we are talking about reviving the vision, last week we started by talking about resurrection and how resurrection is different from resuscitation or recuperation. And as we look at resurrection in terms of revival, and we look at how we need to ignite revival, we talked about how resurrection begins by resurrecting our relationship with Christ Jesus. And so as we are going to continue this momentum for revival, when we look at the word to revive, it is also different from resurrection. Resurrection is to raise something from the dead, to bring new life, to bring life to something that is dead. But to revive is to, yes, bring life back to something, but something that is not dead, but that something that would be unconscious or in a coma. It would be to reanimate or to bring life back to an individual that is unconscious, to bring forth again or to recover. And so when it comes to our life in Christ, when it comes to our Christianity, when it comes to our purpose in the earth today, we definitely want to step into a time where we revive and recover the life we have in Christ. 2 Timothy 2 and 26. And that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. You see, when we look around at our circumstances, when we look around at the earth today, we can see so many instances of the devil, the enemy, just having a rampant activity in the earth. We can look at the obvious things, the police brutality against blacks and brown-skinned people. We can look at the discrimination. We can look at the heinous things our government is doing, and we can see clearly how the enemy is rampant in the earth. But sometimes when we look at our own everyday struggles, trials, and circumstances, unpaid bills and, you know, our pandemic relief money hasn't come in, we didn't get approved for unemployment, we got diagnosed or re-diagnosed with a disease, a sickness, we have to go to appointments and go for treatments, we still can't get rid of the migraines, we still can't get rid of the back pains, we still can't get rid of the joint pains, that we're still fighting against all kinds of diseases, heart disease and diabetes and lupus and whatever else the diagnosis may be. And when we look at our relationships with our coworkers, our family members, our kids, our spouses, our significant others, and yet again we struggle with communicating, or we struggle with betrayal, or we know we should forgive, but we just can't seem to, whatever it is, when we look at our everyday, day-to-day trials, tribulations, difficulties, struggles, pains, and betrayals, it's not quite as easy to see that these two are attacks of the enemy, and that they are attacks at his will, that he only comes into this earth but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But when we look at our lives, we either don't know or neglect or forget to place blame or where blame is due, and to recognize these trials, these circumstances, these pains and issues are attacks of the enemy at his will, not by any fault of our own necessarily, not by any punishment from God that he's inflicting upon us, but by the enemy, who is attempting to do nothing else but to destroy us, to kill us, and to steal all that God has given us. And so much of what we lose in our Christianity, in our joy and our love walk and our relationship with Christ, is stolen and held captive by the devil through the trials each day and every day, and the very basic efforts of life. We need to come into a place not just of revival, but in that course of revival, we hand it all over to God and we let him fix it. We let him handle it. We let him guide us and direct us and show us the answers. And we do it with a sense of joy and praise and relief and rest. We let God fix it. 1 Kings 18 and 30. And Elijah said unto all the people, come near to me. And all the people came near unto him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. In this spirit of revival, yes, it's true, we need to resurrect our relationship with Christ, but in that resurrection, in that resuscitation of our first love, we must also repair the altar of our hearts. That's where we go before the Lord. That's where we find the Spirit of God abiding within us. And that is where we will go to recover and restore our joy, our excitement, our trust in God, our hope, and our wonder in the Lord and his favor upon our lives. When we first came to Christ, we do these things naturally. We have this natural excitement. We have this natural joy. We have this natural thrill and wonder in the one who has just expressed our love to us and the feeling of his love upon us and the knowledge of being forgiven, of having a God who loves us and makes us his own. And so now is the time to retrain those habits that we fall into along the way, where prayer just becomes a thing that we just are obligated to do, where grace is just a habit before a meal, and reading comes only on Sunday morning when pastor pulls up the scripture on the screen, and to retrain those habits that are old and tired and lifeless back into the things that we did when we first came to Christ. Were we excited to know about Jesus? Were we excited to read something new and fascinating and exciting in the Word of God? We need to retrain and restart and press the redo button. Amen. 1 Peter 2:25. For you were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. This is the season where God wants us to return to the shepherd and the bishop of our souls. Now, the shepherd of our souls, the bishop of our souls, is the same one and only Jesus Christ, our Savior. And as a shepherd, he protects us, he guides us, he comforts us, he cares for us, he leads us along the paths of righteousness to clean water, to drink the living water of the Word. He protects us from the wolves and the devils and the enemy. He anoints our head with oil and blesses us and baptizes us. But the bishop of our souls, he guides us, he directs us, he keeps us, he covers us, he teaches us, and he empowers us to move into our own position and our own purpose in the earth. And it says now is the time to return. That's what I mean by restart, redo, and return. Return, yes, to your first love. Return, yes, to those habits we did when we first came to Christ. Return to reading scriptures. Return to praying those heartfelt prayers. Return to praising God with excitement and with your whole heart and with all of your soul. Return to rejoicing and being excited about living a Christian life. Return to that feeling of purpose, of belonging, where you have a place in this family and you have a part to play in the building of the kingdom of God. Return your hearts back to trusting God. Return your hearts back to having faith in Jesus Christ. It's time to return. And you can't just come back to one thing, one time, and be fully revived. Last week we talked about hearing and hearing, meditating and reiterating. We need to return and repeat if we are going to retrain our old ways and be revived unto new life in Christ. Hebrews 11:6. But without faith it is impossible to please him, for he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You see, when we return and we repeat and we continuously repeat that which we have returned to, we do so with diligence. That act of repetition and reiteration and meditation to continually restart and redo and remind us of what we need to redo and return to is an act of diligence when all comprise together. When we commit to redoing and to regoing and to going back and redoing that which we used to do. When we commit to going back and restarting what we started every January. I'm gonna start again to read my scriptures before bed. I'm gonna start again to just start the morning with praise and worship and some private, quiet devotion time with Jesus Christ. Whatever it is that we restart, when we actually restart and repeat, that is the very act of diligence that God will reward. It goes beyond just being rewarded with whatever that specific thing is that we're seeking Him for. So let's say we're seeking Him for healing, and we're diligent about seeking Him for healing. We're diligent about reading our scriptures. We're diligent about speaking health and healing over our bodies. We're diligent about managing our faith and staying committed to the truth that we were healed over 2,000 years ago and that the enemy is just trying to steal our health. When we stay committed to that and we are diligent in that, seeking God for that through His word, yes, we are rewarded with that. That is the promise of the word of God, that when we stay in faith, we are rewarded. That is what Hebrews 11 and 1 says. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That is the very definition of faith, and God promises that faith will not fail us. That if we feel like we're failing in our healing, our provision, our prosperity, whatever it is we're asking God for, it's not that the word isn't working. It's not that God has some exception for you that somehow you've missed out, but it is the faith that keeps us from receiving what the word of God has promised us. So yes, we return with diligence to that which we're seeking God for, but it goes beyond the faith when scripture says, oh, but without faith. It's not talking about if you don't have any faith, because Romans 12 and 3 has already promised that He's given us the measure of faith to every man. Every one of us that comes to Jesus Christ is automatically given the measure of faith that we need to accomplish anything. But we increase that faith within ourselves. We grow our faith within ourselves. We grow in the magnitude and the ability to use little faith, great faith. And people say, oh, well, I only have a mustard seed of faith. But scripture says when you have that mustard seed of faith, you can move mountains. You can tell that sycamine tree to be cast into the sea. It is just a little bit of faith that we can do great things. But like that little mustard seed, it grows into a great, great tree. Our faith grows with that diligence. And not only then, like I said, being able to accomplish that which we have the faith for, but that we are rewarded in relationship with Christ. We are rewarded with His presence. We are rewarded with His Spirit enveloping us and filling us and guiding us and showing us and granting us wisdom and giving us answers and supernatural solutions to the problems around us, not just in our own lives, but in the lives of all those around us. And so we need to return, we need to repeat if we are going to retrain those old ways and be revived into a new life in Christ. And so by diligently seeking God, we are rewarded again, not by just what we're seeking Him for, but we are rewarded with His presence, with His glory, with His joy, and the light of His life shining in us and through us, guiding us like a lamp unto our footsteps, and being a light unto others, that when they see the light of Christ in us and they see the light of Christ shining through us, through our finances, through our provision, through our health, through our relationships. They want to know how and why. How did you and how did you fix that? How did you get that? Why are you doing that? Why do you always have a smile on your face? And we can answer, it's because of Jesus Christ in my life. That is what happens when we revive the light of Christ in our lives. Matthew 5 and 16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. You see, there is work to be done. When we look at the state of the campaign, when we look at the state of the protests against police brutality, when we look at the state of homelessness in our communities, when we look at the state of discrimination against various ethnicities, against those who have chosen a different gender, sexual lifestyle. It's not about whether their lifestyle is right or wrong. It's about every human being has the right to life, and every human being has the right to respect and to not be discriminated against, to know the love of Christ. And how are they going to know the love of Christ for themselves unless they see it through us? We have work to do. And we look at the world around us. God is saying, I have sent the church into the earth for such a time as this. It goes beyond prayer. What can you do? It goes beyond hope and wonder. It's about what has God purposed in you to do. Whatever your part is, no matter how great or small, it all works to the greater good of the kingdom of God. I told someone earlier this week on Wednesday, when I was picking up the bread for our God delivery service, it's groceries on delivery, and we deliver bread twice a week and pick up bread directly from the grocery store to donate. And he said to me, don't you have any volunteers? And I said, no, I don't. It's just my husband and myself. And he said, you know, it's what my wife has wanted to do. She's wanted to volunteer, but she just didn't know where to start or what to do. And I told him, you know, if everybody just does a little bit, then we all end up doing a whole lot. Everybody's little bit put together is the greatest that we all can do together. And that is what God is saying to us. Now is the time. We see the work that's to be done. We see the work that's needed to be done. And when you look at the overall picture of any one thing, it's overwhelming. But when we come together as a church, when we come together under one congregation, and we each put in our little bit into that one congregation, that one church expression of the kingdom of God can then do great and greater things. Jesus Christ himself said in John 14 and verse 12, he said, these works that I do shall you do also, and greater works shall you do. So let's come together under one congregation and begin by doing the works that Jesus did and learn how to do the greater works as well. What are the greater works that the house of his glory has to do? And what is your part in that work? He has a purpose for you to be filled in the earth, and he wants you to do it through the light of Christ that shines in you and through you. But scripture also says, no one lights a candle and puts it under a bushel, under a basket, under a box. That light will be extinguished. No one can see it. But we have a light within us that is given to us so that we can arise and shine. For the glory of the Lord is upon us. Now is the time. Isaiah 61 and verse 2 says, when gross darkness covers the earth and darkness covers the people, that's the time to arise and let your light shine. To stand and admire the one who lights us on fire, Jesus the Son. Shine bright. Ignite. This is the work of revival, to relight the fire, to relight the light that Christ has given us inside, and to seek out the purpose that He has given each one of us, to reignite the joy of the Lord within us, to reignite and rejoice and seek the Lord diligently, to seek Him day and night, to restart and repattern ourselves, to live a life each day that is filled with Christ and in which our light is ignited and shining bright for all to see. That is the work of revival. That is the work of relighting the light of Christ within us. God bless you.
We are an altar of broken stones, but You delight in the offering. You have the heavens to call Your home, but You abide in the song we sing. 10,000 angels surround Your throne to bring You praise that will never cease. But hallelujah from here below is still Your favorite melody. We sing the fire that once burned bright become an ember my eyes can't see. I will remember Your sacrifice. I will abide in Your love for me.
Not wait until it's
here and now shall your kingdom reign. Will you reign? You reign. Oh, we sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen. Thank you for joining me for today's revival message. Again, it may be short, but I just really want to just stir us up to do something fresh that will give us a fresh outlook and a fresh start on our relationship with Christ. Because come September, when we revive the vision, we are going to look at the next chapter, the next path, the next part in the plan that God has for us. And so right now, I invite you to consider giving into this ministry at this time. Anyone who would like to see what God can do through this ministry and how we can reach the community here in Sylmar, how we can reach more and more people with the Word of God and the ministry that He has for us, I invite you to sow an offering into this ministry. Members, or if you would like to be a member, I invite you to bring your tithe into this storehouse. You know, people say, oh, this is good ground, but the good ground is your heart, and the fertile soil of your heart is good ground when you have a heart to give, a heart to share, a desire for others who don't know Jesus to hear the Word of God that comes from this ministry. Your tithe is your symbol of relationship, trust, and partnership with God and with this ministry and with the work that God has for you through this ministry. And then if you have a need in your life, something that you'd like to sow a seed towards, that you'd like to see that financial seed grow up into the change, the need, the deliverance that you have in your life, I invite you to sow that seed. And when you do so through any one of our giving portals on the website, through the live platform or the app, there is a dialog box where you can type out your need, and I will pray in agreement with you. Scripture says whenever two touch and agree, as in touching anything, God will do it. That's His promise. If you believe the word, then you have the right to believe that He will do it when someone stands in agreement with you in prayer. And hey, now is the time to do it, because even as we may be struggling financially, as we give, God uses our giving to give back to us, to bless us, to prosper us, and to open His windows of heaven and pour out His treasures upon us. So however you give, give, in your prayers, your blessings, your support, and your partnership with this ministry. I thank you, and I know God is giving it all back to you. 30, 60, 100-fold blessings to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's go into our final closing prayer. God bless you and thank you. All right, friends, family, visitors, partners, members, thank you for being with me here today. I don't know if you can tell. I think I'm stumbling over my words the whole service because I'm just so excited about these messages. August is a five-week month. There's five Sundays in this month. Five-week month. It is, if you count each Sunday. And it's just exciting. I think I'm excited about what we're doing, this format that we have for our revival month. New songs, spoken word, fresh, creative, casual messages that are just geared to just charge you up, excite you, and remind you that it's all about Jesus' love for you. He's excited to have relationship with you. He's excited about what our Father has planned for each one of you and has planned for our lives and has planned for this ministry. So he's ready. He's waiting for us to be ready too. Amen. And so that's my prayer for today. Father God, thank you for this word. Thank you for choosing us and for thinking of us. Your thoughts towards us are many, and your thoughts towards us are good and not evil. We thank you for thinking nothing but good thoughts towards us. We thank you that you love us so much that you know the hairs on each one of our heads, no matter how many, no matter how few. You've counted each one because you know us, you created us, you loved us, and you created us with purpose. You created us in your image and in your likeness, which means each one of us is an expression of you in the earth, and you desire for each one of us to be expressed in the earth, to manifest your glory in the earth in a specific and unique way that reflects you. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for loving us, for keeping us, for cleansing us, for forgiving us, and for looking at us through the blood of Jesus. You don't see our sins. You don't see our faults. You don't see our inadequacies. You don't hold our sins against us, but in fact, you do not impute them to us, and you have chosen to forget them. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that you look at us like that beautiful church without spot, blemish, or wrinkle, that you look at us and only see all the wonderful things that you've created in us and purposed for us, and you see a life that we could live having received all the things that you've already given us. And so, Father, we thank you right now for all of those things. You've given us all things that pertain to life and godliness, and so we thank you for teaching us how to reach into your spirit and grab everything we need by faith, and for teaching us that faith works by love. It's the love that you have for us that we show to one another, and that we receive in understanding how much you love us. Thank you for loving us so much that you forgave us, you cleansed us, you washed us free of all unrighteousness. Thank you for loving us so much that you give us the Holy Ghost, the Comforter, to walk with us, to be with us, not just to, oh, soothe our sadness and wipe our tears and lift us up, but to empower us, strengthen us, embolden us, and give us the gifts and the abilities to do great and greater things in this earth. Thank you for being our Father and teaching us what a perfect, loving, tender, righteous, holy, and wonderful Father you are. We love you, but we know we could not love you except that you loved us first. Thank you for loving us, for teaching us and keeping us, molding us and shaping us and conforming us into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for blessing us and for giving us the blessing and reminding us that we can once again walk in dominion and in the blessing that was first given to us upon creation. We praise you, we glorify you, we magnify you, we lift up your holy name, and we bless you in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen and amen. Amen. Thank you once again for being here. And until next week, remember, go in the glory of God. Walk in the fullness of His power and receive all the blessings of the kingdom of God that He has for you. I love you. Bye-bye.